in the, one of the most interesting session of the whole seminar. Because I think ultimately what we are trying to say is that the quality of air, quality of environment makes our life, our health different. And we have some of the most experts here who understand the medical science, not only general, but specifically to a particular organ or a disease with us. And this panel actually would actually tell us that what kind of challenges we have. In fact, you might remember that in previous times when we had limited treatment available for tuberculosis, people used to go to a place which was a secluded place, a clean environment, and they would go and stay there, and many of them were ill because of the clean environment alone, and tuberculosis treatment was like that, and that was very popular, and there are still, globally you will find many places in the world even, today those centers still exist, though they are not used for the same purpose, but originally they came up like that. So I think the challenge we all have is that the kind of environment in which we live and the kind of environment which we are facing around is actually creating a kind of a newer kind of disease profile, newer kind of challenges. Though our lifespan has gone up, our quality of life is taking a beating. We have used to be coughing. We have used to get minor cold is like a normal thing for us. But we all don't realize that this is just the beginning of something which is actually creating problems. In our own country, we have seen that old times, people used to use wooden stoves to, wood fire stoves to actually cook. And as a result, many of the ladies of those age have chronic lung diseases and things like that. So I think there are a lot many things, but what is more important is that if a person is suffering from a particular disease, the old science tells us that if you go to a clean environment, the disease healing is faster. Is it relevant? And if it's so, what should it be? I think that is what we are going to basically ask the panel to tell us. And I think we have a very eminent panel, and I will start with Dr. Bhalla. So Dr. Bhalla, I think, is chairman of nephrology at Gangaram Hospital and director of dialysis services also at Gangaram Hospital. And he's also a member of board of Gangaram Hospital. So Dr. Bhalla, what is your view, what is your view that if a person is suffering from a nephrology, a kidney-related problem, what kind of environment he should have it? And what kind of environment the home should have it? What kind of family, what should the family look at to actually help him to live a better life?
Actually, it has been seen in various studies that when we had particular matter more than 10, even as low as 8, that there was increased incidence of CKD. And it has been seen that if more than PM2.5 has been associated with higher incidence of CKD, as well as the special effect on the aging population. The older patients, they are more vulnerable to the effects of air pollution as far as the CKD, the falling GFR is concerned, and the progression of renal disease is faster in these patients. But the biggest study so far, which is quoted everywhere, is a large study of about 7,151 patients from China, where they saw that they analyzed so many biopsies in over 11-year period and followed these patients, and they found that there was membranous nephropathy, one diagnosis histologically proven, which was definitely associated with air pollution, especially PM more than 10. So answering your question, that this and our bad air pollution definitely affects badly on chronic kidney disease incidence as well as progression of the disease, and specifically biopsy wise, membranous nephropathy, histology wise, and if there is lead, then lead leading on to interstitial nephritis as well as Fanconi syndrome and chronic interstitial nephritis.
Thank you, Dr. Bhalla, and I think we got the answer. But my question was that if a patient is already now suffering, and he's one of our family member. How do we really now take care in our home? What kind of environment we should provide him so that he has a better quality of life?
No, I mean, it is a most difficult question that how to improve the quality of air. And for that, you have to have better environment, more greenery in your house, surroundings is green, and of course, use of air purifier. I don't know how much judicial use and how much effective these will be. Some scientific study has to be done to compare whether if air purifier definitely help or not. But now, specifically to kidney diseases, the diabetes, cardiovascular disease, respiratory disease, all these diseases are well proven that there are air pollution is going to affect badly these diseases. Indirectly, all these cause chronic kidney disease. So kidneys are going to be badly affected by air pollution. Regarding how to improve the environment, I don't think that's why this conference is
happening. No, but would you recommend that if the person in your family has a kidney problem, then it is advisable to give a good environment for him in the home?
Definitely, that is the ideal situation, but it's not practical, sir.
Well, that science and technology will definitely develop something for us to make that happen. We cannot leave away from our home, I understand, but I think the message I wanted to basically drive home was that when there is somebody who is related to you, is not well, you are willing to provide, think about providing clean environment, but we ourselves, when we work every day, we don't think like that. And that's the reason that compounds the problem. And finally, when we suffer, we start thinking what we should do about it. Thank you, Dr. Bhalla. And I will ask now next question to Dr. Ashok Kumar. Dr. Ashok Kumar is Director, Professor, Department of Obstetrics and Gynecology at Maulana Azad Medical College and Lok Nayak Hospital, New Delhi. Dr. Kumar, my question is also similar. More importantly, the newborns. Apart from a pregnant woman who comes to your practice, but also more importantly, a newborn, what kind of challenges they face with the pollution, particularly when they are just born, and what should we really do for them to really have a better quality of birth and life thereafter?
First of all, the challenges what they face is in pregnancy, actually it is the exposure to the pollutant, mainly these carbon monoxide, nitrous, sulfur dioxide and particulate matter. All these have a harmful and toxic effect. The important thing is if they are exposed to early pregnancy, like first trimester or mid pregnancy, and the exposure is constant and continuous, then the harmful effects are more prominent. So these mothers can have inflammation in the placenta, leading to decreased blood flow, and inflammation will lead to preterm labors, premature births, and slow or decreased growth of the baby in the uterus. So we will have small babies, and it has been also observed that these babies will have less height also. So all these parameters will be affected because of the pollution. And when these babies are born, because of prematurity and because of small size and low weight, there are few problems which are associated with these. They have behavioral problems, they have neurodevelopmental problems in the later in the life, and it has been also seen that these preterm baby and low birth weight babies have later on are at risk of developing hypertension and respiratory diseases. Even they are prone for bronchial asthma or respiratory diseases in later in life. Even there are few reports nowadays that pollution exposure during pregnancy is associated with autism also. And then there is another problem which is there, that because of inflammation of the placenta, because of these toxins, they are high risk of hypertension in pregnancy. We call it preeclampsia. And again, it is associated with high rate of mortality, parental mortality, and perinatal morbidity also. Then because of, again, it depends on the amount of exposure, these pregnant ladies can have stillbirths also. And even if the baby is born, then this baby can have sudden infant death also after delivery. So there are a lot of challenges to these mothers as well as to these newborns as well as these babies. Now how to take care of these? Again, the problem is how to improve the environment at home and outside. So at the moment we can just counsel the family about these problems and they can look into the matter and see that the pregnant lady is less exposed to these toxins. And for, to achieve this, they can change their home practices, like if they are using chulas or gas or something, so they can use, avoid or minimize the exposure to these. The second is they can avoid during pregnancy the use of paints and fumes from the chemicals which they are using for cleaning the houses and all these things, so these can be reduced. And again, they can have more plants at home. And again, now there is again popular trend in the cities about use of purifier and mask. If the toxic levels are very high, then we can advise them these things also. And we can advise them about the, like in the pregnancy, we advise them about the exercise and walking, etc. Then we can tell them that they should do this in the green areas and they should avoid walking when the pollution levels are very high. Like in the afternoon, vehicular traffic is high and they should not walk around in those areas where the traffic is very high, and they can go to the park where green areas is very high. So in that way, the exposure is reduced. Another important point in this is we should counsel the family, especially the husband, about if he's smoking. Because this secondhand smoke is also dangerous, and there are now reports coming up that yes, secondhand smoke is also associated with harmful effect to the developing fetus, baby, and the newborn. So we should ask the husband not to smoke, and we should counsel the family and the pregnant lady to avoid the smoke also. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kumar. I think we as a country are talking about maternal death and infant mortality and trying to reduce. I guess our health authorities also will take account that environment also is one of the responsible factors for that, and I think something also to be need to be done for that. So we move from gynecology to ophthalmology. So Dr. Grover is with us, and Dr. Grover again is the chairman and department of ophthalmology at Sri Gangaram Hospital. I would request Dr. Grover, I'm not going to repeat the question. The question is, see, if I'm suffering, or if anybody is suffering from an ophthalmological problem, what role environment plays in the creation of the problem? And if the problem occurs, then what kind of precautions environmentally one should take?
I think first and foremost, let me congratulate the Indian Medical Association for this initiative of having brought everybody together to consider what deleterious effects the environment and particularly the air pollution is having on the health, and then the focus can therefore be brought on the administrators to take care of the factors which are bringing this about. As far as ophthalmology is concerned, I think the biggest problems relate to the surface. The changes that take place in the eye as a result of exposure to environmental pollutants is the surface irritation manifesting as dryness, irritation, discharge, burning sensation, stickiness, and manifestation as a full-blown dry eye can occur, because it has been shown that there are histological changes, reduction in goblet cells, and other changes in the conjunctival surface that take place with persistent exposure to the environmental pollutants. And therefore, a dry eye can be precipitated. Of course, the allergic conjunctivitis is brought on by environmental factors, by the air pollutants, which you may be sensitive to, and therefore, they certainly play a role in various kinds of allergic conjunctivitis, including the seasonal conjunctivitis, the perennial conjunctivitis, the atopic manifestations, as well as the sprinkler. So all of them are brought on by environmental pollutants. Now, the as far as the effects on the intraocular aspects are concerned, I think the major concern is the ozone layer and refrigerants bringing about holes in the ozone layer with changes in the UV radiations. Those areas which are exposed to more UV radiations, we know greater exposure to UV radiations is associated with cataractogenesis, it is associated with age-related macular degeneration, which are blinding diseases, and age-related macular degeneration can lead to permanent blindness. So those are the other factors known. Now I think the primary thing that one can do to avoid these problems is, of course, protect yourself from dust, sun. Of course, surface changes also include pterygium formation. We know that it occurs much more in areas where there is more exposure to sun and to dust. So protection would largely include use of protective glasses. The glasses that are 100% UV protective are important to get, because UV is one of the major damaging factors both for the surface and for the intraocular part. So those glasses which are 100% UV protective can help. You can, of course, as everybody said, avoid the dusty and sunny environments, and wash your eyes after you've been exposed to them. Do cold compresses. Use of lubricants is very helpful, because it washes away the exposure that you had to the surface, and therefore reduces the load on conjunctiva and therefore the organic changes that would take place with time. So taking care of the surface by these measures is the one most important factor that I would stress as far as ophthalmology is concerned.
Thank you. I think I'll now move to Dr. Mediratta. And I'm not going to repeat the questions, because I understand the question. Sir, you have a lot of experience both in India and abroad, and particularly in the neurological area, and that's the upcoming challenge for medical science, because they are the most complex manifestation of diseases. So how environment play into that, role into that?
Pankaj bhai, time won't permit. I had the 5 minutes presentation, but first of all, I'd like to express my gratitude to the president of World Medical Association, Ketan Bhai, as well as Dr. K.K. Agarwal, IMA president, for organizing this. When neurology is concerned, you must have heard most of the people were not mentioning the neurological complication. One may think only that the pollutant can cause headache, at the moment, irritability, cognitive behavior alteration. Most of the speakers have spoken about the particulate matter 2.5 to 10, that's micro or macro pollutants. But I don't know how many people have discussed about the nanoparticles or the pollutant, that is very important, less than 2.5 micron. Now, how can they affect the brain? Now, these particles have two ways of going to the brain. One is directly penetrating to the brain, adhering on the cells, they can penetrate the membrane and go into microglia. The others are correlation between lung, brain, and the blood. So they are peripheral irritants which go to the brain and affect that. Now, various neurological conditions which can affect are, the commonest is stroke, second is Parkinson's disease, third is Alzheimer's disease. And in addition, in children, as Dr. Ashok Kumar mentioned, autism and cognitive alteration are very important factors. Now, how these pollutants, there is a person from, a friend from New Zealand, Dr. Valdi Fieger, in 2013 study, where all over the world stroke was discussed and considered from 21 regions of the world. In the lifestyle diseases, we often talk of smoking, obesity, sedentary life, but air pollution is number one now, and one third of the stroke are because of air pollution, and they affect the women more as far as the morbidity is concerned and mortality is concerned. Now the next question comes, how can we prevent this? What Pankaj bhai is asking me, we have interacted in Ahmedabad when I came to your hospital, Arvind Sharma. So the main prevention, I always say, is health, social, and political. Doctors have a role to counsel, but they cannot counsel about the environment. They can ask, okay, remain in the house, remain in a clean area, but one has to go out to earn the living. And in that situation, it's the pure administrative and political impact which can really make the difference. And the difference mask is a very temporary process. Fresh air, air purifiers are very temporary processes. Ultimate process is clearance of the whole environment or the pollution. Now, if you see the Greenpeace report which came just 2 weeks back, half a page report, it says now India has crossed China. Earlier, China had 1.4 million deaths and India had 1.2 million deaths per annum. But now, rather than having 1,197 per million population suffering from air pollution effect and mortality, and India 1,097, now India has crossed China, and the only way is China has made efforts which had been successful. And similarly, though their population is still more than us in a slight way, so what we have is the preventive. 2/3 of population of 7.3 billion in the world live in the low and middle income countries, especially Asia and Africa. The South Asia, where we are holding this meeting, constitutes 22% of the world population. The low and middle income country, only the way out is prevention, what I will say in the end, before it becomes late, we have to act. And who are we? We are scientists, as Dr. Agarwal said, first time IMA has taken this initiative, and all people from Pollution Board, DERI, and we all need to work together to for the further prevention, and we as health professionals have a very important role. That's about from me, Pankaj Bhai.
Thank you, Doctor. I think the more we hear, more we are concerned about the our own health and our own kin's health, which are resulting out of this environment challenges we face. So we'll move to the now to pediatrics, and I request Dr. Anupam Sachdeva, who is the president of Indian Academy of Pediatrics, to also tell us how is our children going to be getting impacted because of this, and are there some preventions or precautions we should take?
Well, thank you very much. Let me make it very clear. If there is anybody who's most vulnerable, it's the children. And there's no doubt in my mind, and the vulnerability is increased because they don't have a voice. We have to be their voice. We as parents, we as people in the community have to be their voice, because we cannot tell what is happening. Children are closest to the ground. The pollutants are the maximum closest to the ground. The heavier gases, the nitrogen oxides, etc., are also closest to the ground. Children take more air per kilogram body weight than the adults. They are indulging in more activities. They indulge in more physical activities than the adults. And when we have to consider the children's health, it is very important that we realize that the children's health is impacted both at home, in the playground, as well as at school. So we have to consider the treatment for air pollution, not as a point of reference, but as a continuum of. In fact, we have always been talking, you know, if a person is ill, what will you do? Put him at home, environmental people. I think we have to change our mindset. We have to keep environment more as a way of life. Improvement in environment has to be a way of life and not just a point reference. The previous session we were talking about, you know, days or peaks of incidence of environment. I was amused because you can't predict what is going to happen tomorrow or day after. So what we have to do is that in our own lifestyle, we have to change the lifestyle in such a way that it becomes a way of life. Taking care of the environment becomes a way of life. Children, as such, are not only impacted by the fact when they are born, but they are impacted when they are in the womb of the mother. Leave aside the womb of the mother. They are impacted even as the gametes, the sperm and the ova, when they are in the ovaries and the testes of the male and the female. So I mean, people are talking about particulate matter. I'm even very worried about the benzene issue, because benzene is a known carcinogen. And the evidence is that if you have leukemia, and it's known to cause leukemia, for having leukemia in children, you have to have a hit earlier on, and then there's a second hit, and it leads to formation of leukemia. This hit may occur in the womb of the mother. It may occur when the child was a gamete, and so on. So we may see the impact of benzene occurring two or three generations down the line. So my plea, my passionate plea, is that we have to get our act together. We have to make sure that we act and act in a concerted effort. This is one way of having a concerted effort, where you're having civil society, you're having doctors, you're having other people around. The WMA is represented here, the IMA is represented. I think we have to take a full-fledged oath that for our future generations, we have to act now. We have spoiled the environment. In fact, people are talking about indoor, people staying indoor when they are sick. I'm also concerned about the indoor environmental pollution, which may be more damaging. In olden days, they used to say, when a person is sick, thoda din ke waqt khidkiya aur darwaze khol do taki hawa aaye. I think that concept was very good. As of today, the indoor air pollution is very worrying. And to take away the indoor air pollution, you have to air the rooms. You have to let the air come in. The air may, and as Dr. Bala suggested and others have suggested, plant trees, have pots plants in them, so on and so forth. There's so many things, little bits which people say, oh, okay, what will I do alone? I can't change the environment alone. But sir, my plea is that if you change yourself, the change is within. You can change the whole world, because the world changes when this change seems to change. So I think as a community, as leaders of the community, we as doctors have a great responsibility in trying to bring out the facts that it's not our generation which is getting spoiled, it is future two or three or four generations also which may get affected. And we have to be proactive. In fact, the Indian Academy of Pediatrics started the environment health way back in 2003. I did a workshop with the WHO on children's environmental health, and it's a big chapter in our essay. We are constantly working towards it. So similarly, the Neonatology Forum has also brought out a lot of things. So we have to act together, and let us bring out a kind of a white paper where we bring in, as Dr. Agarwal was suggesting, that we bring in the points which have to be a checklist for the people at home to do when they have to take care of the environment, people in the office to take care of the environment of the office. How do we improve the schools so that the environment in the schools is improved? We should not have schools in hovel holes in the city. We should have them with good playgrounds. That by itself will improve the environment. So let's bring out checklists for each and every component. And also, the newer constructions, the newer buildings which are there, we have to be damn careful about moving into them with pregnant women or with smaller children, because the volatile organic VOCs will lead to increased incidence of problems in these areas because of the bonded wood and other things which are now used. They constantly release gases. And the other thing is that a lot of our newer buildings which we make have very less ventilation. and that VOC can be taken care of only by ventilation, otherwise it's not going to. So a lot of action points are there, and children are the most bright, not only from the point of view of health, the health of our nation is very important.
I just want to, hello. We welcome Justice Swatantra Kumar, the chairman of National Youth Tribunal, and he's going to give a keynote address after this session. But I thought of requesting him to sit and also listen to what the doctors have to say. And everybody was asking, what can we do? Some of the solutions will come from his mouth. What can we do and what can the community do in tackling the air pollution? We also welcome Dr. P.K. Julka, the oncologist, and former head of department of cancer in on the issue of medical sciences.
So I think Dr. Agarwal, you mentioned, and I think we move to oncology. It's the newer disease burden which our country or the world is facing, and there are many challenges in oncology. Also, there is like anecdotal talks about people saying that a cancer patient is better not treated than treated at times, and things like that. Given that, and also the kind of support and we need to provide for particularly those immunocompromised patients, this quality of air and quality of environment becomes very important. So we would like to briefly listen from you. I just want to remind you that we need to finish this in about next 10 or 12 minutes. So please be brief to the
audience. Yes, thank you very much. What I would like to highlight that we have 14 and a half, according to cancer registry figures, 14 and a half lakh new cancer cases every year, out of which 40% to 50% are tobacco related. And to which, if we add air pollution to it, you can imagine we cross the 50% mark. Now, these 50% of the air pollution and tobacco-related cancers can be easily prevented by primary prevention. We call it primary prevention because if we stop smoking, smoking means smokeless tobacco also included, if alcohol, smoking, all these factors are excluded, and air pollution by itself is, we are protected from it, we can contribute to less than 50% of the cancers which occur in our body. Air pollution not only contributes to lung cancer, which everybody is thinking of, you know, it is not only lung cancer, it is breast cancer, it is leukemias in children, as already highlighted. And it is also some other solid tumors like cancer of the prostate, cancer of the hypopharynx, head and neck cancers. So all these cancers can be caused by air pollution, because just now volatile organic compounds were talked about. Cancer of the prostate, you know, some there was a data that dogs can smell volatile organic compounds in cancer prostate patients. So if they, in their urine, if the dogs smell VOCs, then it is easier to detect cancer in early stages. Now, what I am suggesting, that the air pollution can contribute to major chunk of cancers in all human beings, including the pediatric age group, which he was talking about, in the adults also.
Thank you. We have now last two panelists to give their views, and these panelists are special because one is doctor, the other is expert. And I think Dr. Sanjay Kulshrestha also have unique that apart from being a pediatric surgeon, he has a lot of interest in environment and have been responsible for infant drawing attention of the nation through several initiatives they have done, including getting into the courts to get some orders done. So I request Dr. Kulshrestha to say.
Yes, this air pollution is not only affecting for all age group, it has started affecting the fetus also.
Rajiv Kumar has nicely covered some points. In fetus, it can make three changes. One is it can cause congenital malformation or the birth defects. Second, it can cause intrauterine growth retardation. And third, it can cause a premature delivery. Now it has been established regarding the birth defects, which polyploid is going to cause which kind of birth defects. Now we have known it. Like nitrogen dioxide and CO can cause neural tube defects. Similarly, some pollutant can cause cardiac defects or abdominal defects. So there are three factors that determines the severity. One is type of pollutant. Second is the concentration of the pollutant in the atmosphere. And third is a time of exposure during pregnancy, whether it is during the first trimester, second or third trimester. Regarding the concentration, it has been found when it is a moderately polluted area, the risk of anomalies is two times. When it is a severely polluted area or heavily polluted area, the risk of a congenital anomaly is three times. If you consider Delhi, it is supposed that when the house is nearby 500 meter of a busy road, it is considered a moderately busy area. As per that definition, 55% of the population in Delhi comes in that influential zone. So we have to take care of this. Thirdly is a time of exposure. If the exposure is during the first trimester, then usually it is time of organ formation. Organ formation usually occurs within a few weeks. So if there is exposure during this period, the chances of anomalies are more. If the exposure occurs during second trimester or third trimester, then chances of growth retardation and premature deliveries are more. It is possible that exposure may be there for throughout the pregnancy. So as far as this is a direct impact, there are some indirect impact. It is possible that this pollutant may not make some major changes. It may make some genetic changes. So there may not be any obvious defect or problem in the immediate after delivery. But child is prone to have diseases later on in the life. Like Dr. Ashok Kumar has mentioned, these babies are more prone to have some cardiac problem, blood pressure, asthma, or some diabetes. This has been known. And there may be some indirect factor, like those gents or male who are heavily exposed to these pollutions, like traffic policemen or like driver, they may be having a changes in their sperm quality. It is found that their wives may have recurrent abortion or some genetic DNA changes and may have some kind of anomalies in their wives. This has been known. So as far as the management is concerned, we all know that there is no specific management or drug that we can have. But during the first 3 months, we have to be very precautious. We have to avoid this exposure of this pregnant lady to the severe pollution or to busy roads. They should use mask, air purifier. But general management is we have to curtail the pollution level in gender so that all vulnerable class are benefited, like drivers, traffic policemen, pregnant ladies, and our senior citizens and our shelters. So what I would like to mention that as far as the role of our citizens are concerned, I would like to say a few points on that. Citizens are not showing good concern or they are not coming forward for controlling the pollution. It has been assumed that this pollution is a job of government. We are not supposed to help it better. It is supposed that government has to do something. This is not correct. We are suffering a lot. This is correct. We as a citizen are suffering a lot from it. But we are also one of the cause of this problem. We are the one who are not following the PUC certificate. We are the one when it is we are supposed to purchase an environment friendly car or vehicle. We are not coming forward. We are very much concerned with the luxury feature of a car. We are very much concerned with the safety feature of the car for the road safety. But none of us come and go and ask the dealer how much pollution it is causing, how much exhaust have a pollutant in this car. Practically, we are not asking for that. And we are expecting everything from the government. So we should come forward. And education and awareness in our country are not showing good results. So I believe we need to some good regulation and implementation coupled with the education and awareness, probably that will show some results. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. I think we heard all the panel of doctors talking about the adverse impact on our health. And after hearing them, I think all of us realize that what kind of problem we face because of the bad quality of air around us and environment around us, and how really somewhat we can do it. But I thought it may be more important for us to get actually this thing that how do we take care of our environment, at least at our home. And I think we have somebody who is not medical practitioner, but who is an expert in the area of environment management. Mr. Sanuja, who is with us, who is basically currently working with WHO India office. And we're looking forward from hearing from Mr. Sanuja what really we can do to take care of the environment around us.
So thank you very much. In fact, WHO has been really discussed pretty intensively since the morning, so I thought it would be good to make this particular presentation. I'll not kind of go through the detailed presentation because this is like a 25-30 slide presentation, but I'll try to make three or four points from, especially taking a clue from the morning as to, you know, certain reasons on where more clarity is needed, and then maybe contextualizing into what is what WHO research and data is pointing out towards the health advisory. And this would also be a good, very good synthesis presentation because all the experts have talked about, and I'll maybe talk about from the management point of view. So this is a presentation where WHO has also a regional office in Delhi, and my regional advisor and I am from the country office of WHO in India. So just to give you an outline, what I'm going to talk about is just to give you very basic concepts and maybe one or two points which I want to make, and then talk about the WHO studies, and all especially on the methodology used in the WHO studies, because a lot many times the data of WHO studies have been discussed out here, and then try to give you distinguish between what are day-to-day actions and special actions which need episodic high exposures, and then talk about a little bit about health advisories. Just going very fast on this. I know we are already well conversant with the picture. We say history repeats there since pretty long. So cigarette smoking has been there, and this is important for us to bear in mind when we are discussing particulate matter from air pollution as well. So that's why particulate matter is of great concern to us. And we heard a gentleman also talking about from the neurology as to why the size matters and how the PM2.5 enters. So I'm not going to go into detail of this, but yes, there are PM10, which again is captured in PM2.5, and there are also particles which are lesser than that and which are very much more dangerous for the human body. Just giving a slide from the pathology, which is how the way lungs are affected. WHO talks about certain health impacts. We only take a very highly credible evidence. WHO doesn't even, although there is a long list of the effects of air pollution, and there is now more and more evidence which is existing on these particular health effects, where we heard experts talking about different form of cancers, different form of neurological problems, the eye problems. But what WHO does talk about what you see out here is in red. The three diseases for the adults, which is chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, the lung cancer, and the cardiovascular disease. And in young children, we only talk about the acute lower respiratory infections, even though now there is a lot of data which is existing even on the low birth weight and the still weights, and especially when we talk about the household air pollution. And there are Indian studies for it. For example, Shri Ramachandra University in Chennai is doing a large cohort out there which is talking about household air pollution and its effects on the lower birth rate in children. And that's much more a dangerous problem than even the ambient air pollution, because in terms of exposure. I would talk about the key WHO studies, and I will not certainly repeat, because I think the presentation from the Japanese counterpart did talk about the two studies which have been released by WHO on Monday itself. One is Inheriting a Sustainable World, and then there's an atlas on children's environmental health, which disaggregates all the environmental health parameters, be it sanitation. So there is a lot of talk about India, and India was also been praised on certain efforts. Like, for example, this particular report very well covers about PM's Swachh Bharat mission. So how India is trying to eradicate itself by this open defecation free by 2019. So this is also one environmental health parameter, because again, if we look at diarrhea and pneumonia, these are the two largest killers in India for under five child mortality. So these are the data which is there from the WHO studies. Just making a remark on how do we kind of do about these studies. These are like global studies, these are not specifically for India, but has only the Indian data, maybe a part of it covers kind of India. And the primary source of data is from the national places, where we kind of ask the national governments to submit us the data, or if the national governments do not have that particular data, then we kind of also go to the regional level, because there are quite a few studies which are there at the regional level which are there. Or then we kind of also sometimes, if the data is not available, then we use certain conversion factors which are maybe at the national level or at the city level. So for example, if we don't have for cities for Punjab or UP, then we would use the conversion factors for Delhi, and sometimes PM 10 or PM 2.5. So these are the kind of ways in which it is done. And mainly the annual mean concentration of PM 2.5 is kind of highly relevant for these health impacts. And especially the way now the government is trying to focus on more and more monitoring, and the way we also heard that in Delhi itself, from 6 monitoring stations we will be going to 26 monitoring stations. So there would be more and more data would be coming in, and then these health response impacts which are coming in would be much more strengthened, and there would be much more data which would be coming out of it. So that's on this particular thing. I won't it's kind of get stuck maybe. Can you please help me? Okay, so it's already there. What can we do about the current situation? Just making a point from, I think in our previous session, there was a person from media. We have been in Diwali during this particular day. We were talking about there were regular media coverage on, what to do when these kind of episodic events occur, because this was like almost a very episodic, once in a, say, 37 years or 40 years. And then there were host of things which were presented, whether use of jaggery would help us, or use of kind of muleti, tulsi, grapes. We know there is a lot of traditional knowledge within our society which kind of talks about it. We also heard Dr. Alka Pandey talking about some yaks which could certainly help. But then there needs to be more and more evidence which needs to be generated on that. We know it's traditional knowledge, but that needs to be corroborated with the kind of current situation which we are in. And as what she very rightly mentioned, that we need to kind of do those experiments, do those cohort researches, and generate more evidence whether when we kind of give these health advisories to the general population of the country. Just kind of what we are experiencing, we have already seen these are 700 levels. And to give you just a glimpse of 2016 RK Puram data of last 2016, which we kind of did, and RK Puram is very closely in South Delhi, we had almost 70% to 80% of the days which were bad air quality days. And only during the months of July and August, they were like roughly around 20%. And that also not the WHO standards of air quality data where I'm talking about. I'm comparing it to with the Indian standards of PM, where we go up till 60 micrograms per meter cube. So this is like making a fact that most of the days, the air quality is bad in India. And what are the kind of 4 points, the major, the management, I would say, the overriding goal, as what all the panelists have said, to prevent and reduce exposures. Pay particular attention to vulnerable groups, be it the children, or be it the elderly, or be it people who with chronic diseases, that they have to be paid particular attention. During short-term high episodes, we need to really introduce special measures. And last Diwali was a kind of a short-term high episode. But then the data previously shows that it's not only we are talking about those short-term episodes, but regularly on a larger level, where most of the year, Delhi and its adjoining areas are kind of, are running with very high levels of air pollution. And at all times, avoid activities which are certainly adding to the problem. Factors, duration, concentration, proximity, and weather. And we know that, yes, in Delhi, especially the month of winters are kind of situations get particularly worse. And the individuals, I would say, again, which I'll not kind of repeat, age, health, pregnancy, low socioeconomic data adds to it. Just kind of also talking about air pollution at the workspace, about volatile organic compounds and issues of that which have been captured. I would not like to go into detail due to the paucity of time. Talking about indoor air purifiers, which sometimes have to be used, but then again, this is not a kind of a measure which can be there for our entire population, because this is for very very kind of minuscule percentage of for people. Just to give you what WHO in India is currently doing, you heard Dr. Damodar Bachchani in the morning, and he where he talked about. WHO also has been supporting this particular steering committee, which, and I think that that's somewhere which I need to kind of place out here in India, which is a historic decision by Ministry of Health and Family Welfare all around the world, because nowhere health ministry has taken such a lead on air pollution, where they established this particular air pollution steering committee, which was co-chaired by, I think, Dr. Reddy from PHFI and Dr. Ambuj Sagar from IIT Delhi, and they submitted the report in 2015, and then where WHO has been supporting this whole process, and now we are trying to translate the recommendations of this particular steering committee into actions. So what we are doing is we are trying to communicate about the health impacts to the policy makers. We are trying to support these particular committees, trying to support the institutional framework of the country on air pollution, update about the health-based value guidelines, generate data at the global level as well as at the country level to kind of create more and more awareness, and then working with other UN bodies and stakeholders on this particular issue. Medical professionals certainly, and that's what is kind of IMA is taking up that responsibility, and I really appreciate the efforts of IMA on this particular thing. That's it. I think those are the points from my side. Thank you very much. And in case if you need any further information, our email IDs of the relevant people at WHO are displayed out here. I would be more than happy to kind of answer any questions. Thank you very much.
Yeah, I think I don't want to summarize. I think Mr. Saluja has covered all the points in great details, and for a paucity of time, I would not like to summarize. But I want to thank the whole panel. I think they have given us a lot of good input. So let us give a big hand to the panel for the nice input they have given.